צהריים טובים.
Good afternoon.
האתגר שעומד לפתחנו, העדכון הדחוף שאת שואלת עליו,
טלי, זה שינוי תרבותי.
דיון בתפיסת הביטחון, או עדכון של תפיסת ביטחון, מחייב את החברה הישראלית ואת ההנהגה הישראלית לעשות בדיוק את מה שהיא לא אוהבת.
לחשוב,
לתכנן, להתחייב, לפעול בשקיפות ולשאת
באחריות. את זה בישראל של 2015, או בעצם בישראל
מאז ומעולם,
I mean, never have they liked doing all these things. Let's take protective age. I think the
bonton
of the strategic summary in our Israeli media was something like the IDF didn't provide the goods.
The
IDF did not provide the goods.
And
that is why there was a sense of missing the opportunity and so forth.
However, האם למדינת ישראל יש משנה סדורה כלפי
החמאס?
ורמז. היום בבוקר ציטטו ברדיו את אלוף פיקוד הדרום.
ודיברו
שבקונטקסט של הירי האחרון של הרקטה מרצועת עזה, החמאס מסתבר הוא זה שיפתור את הבעיה. במחי לילה ובבת אחת, החמאס, שהיה בעיה כל כך כבדה, הופך אולי, אני שואל, אני
אסביר, becomes part of the
solution.
I mean, have you ever seen in the state of Israel, is there ever a strategic statement, some sort of a long-term logical statement as to our objectives vis-à-vis Hamas? So when there is a protective edge operation, is it fair to ask or to demand of the army to produce the goods when there are no goods, when there is no definition? Let's take it a step forward. Let's say there were a definition.
Then would
the IDF really has to always maneuver and, you know, the pet troopers, Golani and Givati units, as important as they may be, are they really able to provide the goods in the sense that, again, there will be an Israeli solution or response, some sort of a solution, a social solution, military solution to the Gaza Strip? Don't we require some sort of an updating or discussion about our security approach here in Israel and how we relate to our neighbors? Another example, Alex touched upon it, the relationship between the IDF and the political echelon, because IDF is an army of a democratic state, no question about it, people talk about a push, but of course that's not serious. IDF, of course,
is
subject to the political echelon, but on the informal side, people say that the IDF is too strong, but that is not true. The truth is that the civil echelon is too weak, and since the IDF is required to provide security, it enters that vacuum that the political echelon that operates partially, in a good case scenario, is not there. I'll give you an example.
Again,
deciding what objectives are, the methodology here in the state of Israel is all awkward. The IDF builds some sort of a scenario of threat. It is true that formally speaking, the political echelon has to approve it. But in a rectified state, with good and healthy ties between the politicians, the government, and the IDF, we could expect that the approach would be different. Alex talked about the budget. Okay, let's talk about the budget.
2 years ago,
the newspaper said that a sixth submarine was acquired, again, cost 400, 500 millions, again, and this was in opposition to the IDF. How much was it? Okay, about 2 billion shekels. By the way, 2 billion shekels.
I mean,
they have a very significant alternative in terms of welfare, in terms of education, and in things that relate to social resilience. By the way, this is an interesting historical point here, because that prime minister at the time, who talked about an agenda of let's, you know, let's treat that old lady in the corridors of the hospital in Nahariya, he was the one who bought that six submarine. So what, did that six submarine throw out that old lady in the corridor in the Nahariya hospital? But of course, we understand what the priorities are. We can see it quite clearly what our priorities are. And by the way, it's an additional anecdote, if you will. Again, that sort of limping security approach
built
one strategic arm for the state of Israel, that is the Air Force. The minute we bought that sixth submarine, of course, we actually conveyed something else, something in between the lines, and the IDF has two strategic arms. Now, when we build strategic arms or branches, it's great, it could be in-depth operations, but it costs money. It costs money within the army. for example, again,
we ground forces, you know, why? Because suddenly we discovered there are no tanks in IDF, or the tanks that we have are 50 or 60 years old. On average, it's no military secret, and that is the result of prioritization. But where was the social discussion? Where was the instruction from the political action? Was it? Did it exist? Again, let's compare something about the American document or paper that's a national security strategy, American national security strategy. Where did I get it from? This is from the internet. I didn't need any spies to get this for me. Transparency, February 2015. What is written? This obligation of the president to the state, to
משפט ראשון חזון, משפט שני כלכלה, משפט שלישי חינוך, רק במשפט הרביעי ובפסקה הרביעית
צבא וביטחון.
ואגב, בתוך המסמך האמריקני, מי שמסתכל גם על התוכן אחרי הקדמת הנשיא, אז יש לנו security, prosperity,
values, prosperity and values and international order.
בתוך הסקיוריטי, למשל, אנחנו מוצאים את ה-climate change ואת הבריאות העולמית.
And we find world health. Different perception altogether. I'm not saying we have to, you know, copy paste and whatever is right for Washington is right. For Israel. But seriously speaking, you know, we have from whom to learn, and we and forgive me, we can be jealous and we can be envious. As to the front, to the interior front, the
Meridor
committee added that fourth leg or fourth branch, not only deterrence, not only defense, social resilience, our ability to absorb. Again, these are key terms. When did we talk about it? In the security context, you can always connect it to the budget, of course. As to the home front and the home front command, it's not an organizational question. Who is going to manage everything in times of emergency? And let me just say this. You know, if God forbid there will be third Lebanon war, will somebody seriously think that the IDF headquarters can actually deal with, again, missiles hitting Tel Aviv when they are fighting in the Lebanon front? So where must the home front be? Who must manage the home front? Who manages the home front, Israeli home front? Who also, you know, deals with putting out fires in all senses of the word? Again, this has to be at the very core of our discussions, and they are not, because we are missing, we are lacking a security worldview. As to the home front, let's go to something more specific. What about evaluation of risk? The state of Israel needs a national psychiatrist. They keep frightening us constantly with Iran. They keep frightening us with the tunnel. They frighten us with kidnapping of soldiers. They frighten us.
You
know, even in the last week, with the boycott.
אני לא אומר שזו מניפולציה.
I'm not saying it's manipulation.
אבל מישהו צריך לדרג את הפחדים הללו.
Somebody has to grade these fears.
מישהו צריך לתעדף אותם.
Somebody has to prioritize them. האם באמת האיום האיראני שהוא איום משמעותי
מאוד ויעיל כאן קיומה של מדינת ישראל בשנים הקרובות הוא שקול לאיומים האחרים שמניתי? ודאי שלא.
Is it the same or is it weighty as other pressure? Of course not. But if part of our duty is to frighten people, say any politician runs to the mic or goes to any channel in the media and starts frightening people.
בגן הילדים זו הגננת שמרגיעה.
You know, in the kindergarten, it's the kindergarten teacher that
יש גורמי ביטחון רציניים מאוד במדינת ישראל שיכולים לתעדף איומים וצריכים לתעדף איומים ולהגיד את זה בכל רם שלום וברור לחברה הישראלית. ומהערכת פחדים וסיכויים אני הייתי רוצה לומר מילה על ההזדמנות.
מה יש לגבי ישראלים כלפי הרשות הפלסטינית?
לא הפחדים יש פה, יש פה גם הזדמנות. האם נאום בר אילן קובע? טוב לרגע סוגריים, האם נכון לקבוע אסטרטגיה לאומית בנאום בר אילן כמו שאגב, האם את ההתנתקות צריכה לעשות בנאום
הרצליה?
או האם אחרי נאום בר אילן ערב הבחירות אמירה של ראש ממשלה שינתה באחת את סדרי
העדיפויות של מדינת
ישראל? אנחנו צריכים מבוגר אחראי שיגיד לנו, יש לנו זכות לדבר. ואני רואה שעובר הזמן, אז יש לי כך מהערות לסיום. תראו, תפיסת הביטחון איננה נוסחת קסמים. אי אפשר להגיד שאם יהיה טקסט כתוב תבואנה, הפתרונות יבואו מעליהם. אבל תפיסת ביטחון נותנת רפרנס. תזכרו, נזכור את המשנה בפרקי אבות. גם מאין באת לאן אתה הולך.
You have to remember where you come from and where you're going, because in the changing reality, now it's huge reality where the world is keeps changing every single second. The threat of yesterday is not the threat of tomorrow. We need some sort of reference, that anchor that we can make compatible, and we should always again examine in light of this reference and prioritize and build up our forces vis-a-vis this reference. What do we have instead of this? We have creative thinking, again, Ben Gurion from the beginning of the 50s, with all those basic ideas that were presented. presented here, we have more an updated idea of Dan Meridor that added another branch to our defense perception. Is that enough?
No, this is a session of statements and generals
or things that have to do with practice. Let's take the oral versus the practical. Again, at the end of the day, things are not coherent. Do we have the right, or do we, or is the political echelon, is it obligated to something else? Yes. We have the right to know in advance what the objectives of Israel are, because if Hamas, if God forbid, will there be a third round of warfare? Not in real time when the cabinet ministers are running between microphones, and each one suddenly invades his own agenda ad hoc for opportunistic purposes, but an orderly thought
and
paper for us to know what our objectives are. Let me just give you a tiny, again, this is just one tiny example. But here, this is my concluding remark. For this, we need a very significant change in Israeli culture, especially in the leadership culture. We have to start thinking, we have to start planning, we have to commit ourselves, we have to conduct ourselves transparently and take responsibility. Can this all happen in Israel of 2015? So in our cynical state, the answer would probably be no. But by the way, we're not only a cynical state, we're also a Zionist state. And Herzl taught us, if you wish, it is no legend.